desire to begin my program with a quote from Augustine in the book The City of God, Book 1, Chapter 26. He states that no man should put an end to this life to attain that better life we look for after death, for those who die by their own hand have no better life after death. It was the Christian belief throughout the centuries that a Christian, a person that commits suicide, would not make it to heaven. Then in the modern time, this belief started to change. We see now people like Alistair Begg saying a person commits suicide, they might have gone to heaven if they're a Christian. You know what we're doing by saying those things? We're putting a way out to people, saying you're suffering, there's a way out. You could be with Jesus more faster if you just end it. Literally, that is what we're doing. And then we wonder and we say, why there's so much suicide in the world? Well, you yourself are putting an open door for that. The church is not preaching against suicide no more. The church is not saying, if you don't persevere to the end, you're not saved. And I'm wondering about these preachers. Are they real Christians? Is Alistair Begg a real Christian for saying such stuff? Oh, you step on ground that you shouldn't talk about. Alistair Begg, he's a great Christian. Man, he's a joker. He's a clown in the pulpit. That's not. Christians should not be joking around so much in the pulpit. He's after the buck. Anyway, I guess everybody's after the buck. Anyway, who cares about Alistair Begg except those that are there, his fans. Anyway, I don't care. I don't care if I step on some toes today. I'm always stepping on somebody's toes. The Bible says this. It says it in Matthew 24:13, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. He who endures to the end shall be saved. Matthew 10:22, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but he who endures to the end will be saved. Mark 13:13, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but he who endures to the end will be saved. Revelation tells us, Revelation 2:7, he who hasn't hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Revelation 2:10, do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. Revelation 3:10, because you have kept my command to persevere, I will also keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole earth to test those who dwell on the earth. I want to understand, when you understand, part of being a Christian is to persevere to the end of your life. If you take that shortcut, you're not persevering. Well, Harris, Kakoulides, have you ever thought about suicide? Yes, I struggle with suicide every single day at times. not every single day per se, but the thoughts of suicide does enter my mind at times. Why? Because I was used to the marriage life and now I'm a widower. Why? Because it's lonely sometimes, but yet I persevere to the end. Who cares about what I feel at the moment? You know, these feelings sometimes pass away, and they do. They're there for a moment. You might get a sad feeling, and then it's gone. There were many men of God who wanted to end their life. You think about Jonah. What did Jonah tell God? Jonah was a very person who wanted to die. In Jonah 4 verse 3, he says, "Therefore now, Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." The men of God in the past, they don't like their lives in the past. Just like many of us don't like what situation we're going through. But we have to persevere to the end. Don't listen to these these men like the one who made the apologetic Bible. There's a defense for people who commit suicide by misquoting the scriptures. I want you to understand that. Don't think that everything is fine and dory when it comes to people who commit suicide. Don't think they're saved. Maybe it's evidence that they're not saved. And it's a sad thing. I don't rejoice when I hear someone that was a Christian that committed suicide. I don't rejoice over that. I grieve over that. But as long as I'm teaching in the church that you should not commit suicide, I feel right in my heart that I contributed. A person hearing this message will hear and say, "I shouldn't commit suicide. I'm tempting God." We shall not tempt the Lord our God. What does A.W. Pink states in Preserving Grace, Suicide, 1937? He states, "Probably there are very few Christians, but at one time or the other, seriously ponder suicide. Yet the Lord in his covenant faithfulness either renewed their graces, changed their intentions, or thwarted their efforts as he did more than once with the hymn writer of blessed memory, W. Cowper. And to those Christians who are fearful lest such a terrible ending as suicide should be their lot, we close by reminding them of the sure promises of the preserving hand of the Most High over his saints. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all." Psalms 34:19. "Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation." 1 Peter 1:5. Understand that what I'm telling you is no joke. You end your life. You don't know what's going to happen to you in the next moment. You take your life, and I'm going to tell you, that's an evidence. You were never saved to begin with. What about those in 9/11? They had no choice. They had no choice to jump off that building or be burned alive. They had to choose one death or the other. That does not count. What I'm talking about is those people, because they're feeling depressed or depression and is very strong, they figure, "Well, if I commit suicide, I'll make it to heaven." How many people thought about that? I want to be close to Jesus. I want to be so close. I'm tired of this life. Well, don't you think I'm tired of this life? Don't you think being a pastor before and losing my church? Don't you think that certain things that I think about at times, I lost this. What next I'm going to lose? I'm not doing that good with my health at times. Well, the enemy will say, well, commit suicide. You'll be with Jesus much faster. No, you won't. Don't think that you will. Don't think that you will. The church before that, before these modern times, if a person committed suicide, they will give them a different kind of funeral. But this all changed. This all changed. Suicide was a crime for the church before that could have no penance imposed upon it. The church denied the suicide the honor and solemnity of a Christian burial. They used to not give them a Christian burial when a person committed suicide, and allowed him to lie excommunicated and deprived from all memorial in her prayers after death. Most likely that's in reference to the Roman Catholic Church. I'm looking at and I'm reading from the Encyclopedia of Biblical, Theological, and Existential. I can't pronounce the word. Literature. You know, that dictionary. I didn't want to say it. I think I said the wrong word. I didn't sound it right. You know, that dictionary by the John McTalk and James Strong in 1895. Encyclopedia of Theology, if you want to call it. It says a whole bunch of other stuff. And it says that at that time, they wouldn't give them a proper burial. They would not pray for them. I think it's a reference to the Roman Catholic Church, because no Christian should be praying for the dead. Only Roman Catholics and Greek Orthodox do that. We shouldn't be praying for the dead. In England, this crime was punished not only with they would take their goods, but the body of the suicide was buried in the night at the crossing of two highways with a stake driven through the body. This ancient rule was repealed by George the Fourth or George the Fifteenth. George the Fifteenth. And now the burials take place in the churchyard between 9 and 12 p.m. Well, the Roman Catholic Church changed their opinion on suicide. Now they believe that suicide people will make it to heaven. And it's funny, when the Roman Catholic Church changed their ideas, the Protestant world now is copycats. They'll copy from the Roman Catholics on things. Instead of the Protestant world being an example to Roman Catholics, maybe they'll just leave the Pope and start being true Christians. What's my view about the Pope? I believe the Pope to be Antichrist. I hold the Protestant view, the old Protestant view, which is now replaced by many people. But today's topic is on suicide, and we'll continue talking about this after this song. Give me a moment.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou
art. What a beautiful song, How Great Thou Art. I love that song. It's just a wonderful song. It brings you to the presence of God. And as I was saying, as Christians, we have to persevere to the end. That is an evidence that you are truly saved. We're told in Scripture that the cowards will not make it into the kingdom of God. If you commit suicide, you are a coward. Let's go to, I think it says in Revelation. Let's try to find it. I think it's Revelation. I think it's in Revelation 21. I'm not sure. Yes, Revelation 21, verse 7 and 8. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But those that are cowards, the unbelieving, the abominable, murderers, sexual immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake, which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Notice, the cowards. If you are a coward, well, I got fears. Well, Man, I got fears. I'm gonna be honest with you. I got fears, but I have to overcome these fears. I fear going out in this Kensington area. Seriously, you hear gunshots. You see people with their faces busted open. But what can I do? Am I supposed to stay in my room, my apartment room, all day and night, not go out and do grocery shopping? Or a witness to anyone? No. I have to face those fears. When my wife was dying, I was fearful of being a widower, and now it's been a year, and I've been facing that fear. And each day, I fear being alone. I being honest with you, I long for a wife at times. But guess what? Till God gives me that wife, I have to face that fear of the single life. And if God chooses not to give me one, well, He's still a great God. And He's still a great, wonderful, glorious God because He died for my sins. And he has a right to give me something if He wants, or not give it to me if He doesn't. But anyway, let's talk about the suicide topic. We have to face our fears. And a person who commits suicide, he's not facing his fear. He or she is not facing their fear. They are a coward. People who commit suicide, they don't persevere to the end because they're trying to get a way out. But you may say, well, committing suicide is kind of brave. No, it's not. Because they know after these brief seconds, everything is over. Committing suicide is a cowardly act. You are a coward if you commit suicide. Oh, it's a coward act. I'm not facing my situation in life if I commit suicide. You know what? Jesus could have, in one moment, in the cross, He could have blinked and everything be over in less than 1 second. He didn't have to go be 6 hours on that cross. Yet He faced the 6 hours for you and for me. Jesus could have blinked and He could have said, well, let me just die at that moment, in this moment. But He persevered those 6 hours. We need to persevere and look at what's ahead of us. Your life is affecting someone else's life. The fact that you persevere is giving someone else desire to persevere as well. If I end my life, those who look up to me will most likely say, what's so bad about it? Committing suicide? Harris committed suicide, and look, he's a man of God. Well, if I commit suicide, I'm not a man of God. I'm a chicken if I commit suicide. Oh, you shouldn't say words like that. Well, I say a whole bunch of words I shouldn't be saying at times in the radio or in the internet. And I don't care if people want to censor me. Luckily, I'm a Christian. I'm not going to use the F word or other words. And if I do it in one moment, come out with something, please forgive me. Because I'm a man that sometimes I get angry and words come out. And I ask God forgiveness when those words come out. But I persevere by Christian walk. And so should you. You're called to persevere. The Bible says they were with us. But they did not stood with us. Because they were not truly Christians. That's 1 John says something like that. They were not of us. Because if they were of us, they would persevere with us. and persevering in your faith is evidence of your salvation. If I don't continue in my faithful walk with the Lord, even though I'm going to have stumbles, I might fall to lust, I might fall into saying a bad word, or I might have some falls that, man, every day we have to ask God forgiveness because we fall. Every day we have a slip and fall, and sometimes we don't fall that day and we persevere the whole day without committing a sin that we don't acknowledge. And every time you sin, you know you're sinning. Sometimes you sin and it's like it doesn't come to your head till like the day after, the week after. You're like, wow, I should have never done that. Oh man, I hope I didn't grieve the Holy Spirit in doing that. So we sin. We're sinners. We sin less and we feel worse when we do. But we sin. But we're called to persevere in our faith. And by Jesus Christ, we will persevere. We have to look at Him. Our goal is Jesus. Our goal is to do what God called us to. And God has called you for great and awesome things. God has called you for great and awesome things if you are a believer. If you love Jesus, well, God has called you for great things. No matter what's your situation. You found out you had a disease. You found out that you're going to die. Well, don't rush things over. You might not die as quickly as you think. There's so many people who had cancer and suddenly they overcome cancer. There's many people who have a fatal disease and suddenly God does a miracle and heals them. Or if He doesn't do a miracle, He uses them as an example to other Christians. Look at this person. This person has stomach cancer, and that person is still persevering in their faith. Amazing. I need to persevere in my faith. Look at that person. That person has cancer. And look, that person's still serving the Lord. That person has not been angry with the Lord. Look at that person. That person's dying of AIDS. And yet that person's strong. Look at that person. That person's in a wheelchair. And that person, man, that person knows the word. And that person loves the Lord. They're not bitter towards the Lord because they're in a wheelchair. Because they have this disease. Or no, they're persevering. They are an example to us. When something bad happens to us, we have to persevere. We cannot stay the same. We cannot stay the same. We need to fight the good fight. Let's put another hymn before we finish. Lord bless you all and have a great day, and I'll continue making another program this day later on. Love y'all. Bye.